what faith can do. Welcome home to Radiant Life Church, where everyone counts.
Thanks for joining us for our online service today. Do you know what next Sunday is?
Absolutely.
And what's that?
Oh, well next Sunday, after Drive Up Church, we will have our annual business meeting, but I like to call it the annual business party because it's when we get together to celebrate all the great things that God is doing through the ministries of Radiant Life Church.
That is awesome, and I'm looking forward to that. But you know, something else is happening next Sunday. You know, to help you out, why don't we take a quick look at this video from Skit Guys.
So Valentine's Day is coming up. What are you getting your wife?
Nothing.
I don't think it works that way. Nothing?
Nothing.
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 Diabolical.
Yep, this year for Valentine's Day, I'm the present.
Oh, can I please be here when you tell her that?
Look, as if our wedding vows weren't enough. Through the years, I power washed the deck. I YouTubed how to build a walk-in closet. I even changed the toilet paper roll. Sometimes without even being asked. I took her to Graceland twice.
But Graceland isn't a two-trip kind of place.
And do you know where she has her weekly women's Bible study every Monday night?
Do I want to know?
Right over there, in front of my 70-inch crystal clear True Tone LED while I sit in the back room watching Monday Night Football on my kid's cracked iPad.
You saint.
So, this year, no presents, just presents.
What'd you just say?
I'm not getting her any presents. I'm giving her presents.
So, let me get this straight. For Valentine's Day, you're not getting her any presents with a T. You're giving her your presents with a C.
That's what I said. Presents, not presents.
Diabolical.
Hey, honey.
Yeah?
As you can imagine, Valentine's Day did not go well for Jerry this year. Don't be a Jerry. Make those you love feel special.
There's a good message in that video. Don't be a Jerry.
That's true, but I think there's even a great word in that video, and it was found in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8. That says, above all, love each other deeply because love covers over a multitude of sins. This is a great week, a great time to just share the love of Jesus with those around us.
Absolutely. Let's take a moment and pray together, shall we? Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are the God of love and you have made your love known to us through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray that you would help each one of us to extend your love, your grace, and your goodness to those who are closest to us, Father, by sharing a word of encouragement, even a gift in the coming days, God, to extend the joy that we have in Christ Jesus.
Yes, and Lord, I lift up our church family to you and just pray, God, in the name of Jesus, that you would just pour out your blessing on them. God, keep them safe through the season. And Lord, I just pray that you would remind them that they are not alone, that you are with them, God, and you are for them. And Lord, I just pray that you would continue to do a great and mighty work through this church, through your people, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's worship together.
Grace that taught my heart to fear.
shy. But God will call me below, will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
Over the past year, our family has increased the frequency of connecting puzzle pieces as a way of working together while coping with the ongoing crisis. In life, I enjoy the little puzzle pieces that help tell the stories of people's lives. There are certain words and phrases that Christians tend to use more frequently than others. And when we hear those words, it's like holding a puzzle piece that suggests we may be part of the same extended family, the family of God. The word blessing is one of those words. When we speak of blessings, we're talking about something good that we don't deserve. A blessing isn't generally an accomplishment, an award, or a responsibility. A blessing is almost always a gift. When we live with out-of-control faith, we not only become more aware of the blessings that God has provided to us, but we begin to find God extending blessings through us to benefit the lives of others. Through the lineage of Abraham, we see a pattern of extending blessings from generation to generation. Let's return to Hebrews chapter 11, where we pick up reading at verse 17. By faith, Abraham, when God tested him, offered Isaac as a sacrifice. He who had embraced the promises was about to sacrifice his one and only son, even though God had said to him, "It is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned." Abraham reasoned that God could even raise the dead, and so in a manner of speaking, he did receive Isaac back from death. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau in regard to their future. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed each of Joseph's sons and worshiped as he leaned on the top of his staff. By faith, Joseph, when his end was near, spoke about the exodus of the Israelites from Egypt and gave instructions concerning the burial of his bones. Would you bow your head with me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for speaking to us today through your word. Lord, we thank you for calling us to live with out-of-control faith. As you have poured out blessings in our lives, God, help us to partner with you in extending blessings to others. Lord, I pray today in the name of Jesus that in so doing, we will shine your light more brightly in this world and that you will be glorified through our out-of-control faith. We pray these things in Christ Jesus' name. Amen. Let's take a moment and look deeper into Abraham's near sacrifice of Isaac. In Genesis 22, God speaks to Abraham and commands him to take Isaac to a specific mountain in what would become Jerusalem. We'll get back to that in a minute. Abraham knew that it would be through Isaac that God said his promises would be fulfilled. And Genesis 22 tells us that Abraham obeyed God to the point that he took Isaac to Mount Moriah, made an altar on which he placed his son, and drew a knife to sacrifice Isaac to the Lord. Before continuing, I need to point out that this is a unique an important event in history that proved to be a test of Abraham's faith and evidence of God's mercy through substitutionary redemption. While Abraham clearly could not have understood why the Almighty would ask him to do such a thing, Abraham's faith was greater than his ability to comprehend all that was about to unfold. So with out-of-control faith, Abraham was actually engaged in extending blessing through obedience when he placed Isaac in God's hands. The Holy Spirit inspired the author of Hebrews to give us insight into Abraham's out-of-control faith in Hebrews 11:19, where we read, Abraham reasoned that God could even raise the dead, and so in a manner of speaking, he did receive Isaac back from death. If the notion of Abraham being instructed to sacrifice his one and only son or the mention of God's ability to raise the dead stands out to you, it's because this passage foreshadows the most pivotal element of our faith. Remember I said the mountain was in a place that would later be known as Jerusalem? Let's get back to that now. Our Heavenly Father commanded Abraham to take his one and only son, placing him in God's hands on the very mountain where the temple of the Lord would eventually be built. On that same mountain, God's one and only son, Jesus, would be sacrificed to pay the price for our sin. That's substitutionary redemption. And it's also there that Jesus would rise from the grave and conquer death. On that mountain, as Abraham drew his knife, he was stopped by one who was called Melech Yahweh in Hebrew, or the angel of the Lord. Now, Melech means angel, and Melech Elohim is an angel of God. But this angel is called by the only name by which God calls himself, Yahweh. The angel of the Lord in this passage is the pre-incarnate Son of God, Jesus. This is what theologians call a theophany, or a physical appearance of God. In Genesis 22, 12 through 14, we read, "Do not lay a hand on the boy," he said. "Do not do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God because you have not withheld from me your son, your only son." Abraham looked up, and there, in a thicket, he saw a ram caught by its horns. He went over and took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide." And to this day it is said, "On the mountain of the Lord, it will be provided." If you have any doubt about this being Jesus speaking to Abraham, remember that the angel of the Lord, Melech Yahweh, in this passage didn't say, "You have not withheld from God your son." He said, "You have not withheld from me your son, your only son." Jesus, the one and only Son of God, redeemed Isaac from death by providing a ram as a sacrifice. And Jesus, the Son of God, would be sacrificed on that same mountain to redeem us from our sin. And 3 days later, he rose from the dead before ascending into heaven. From generation to generation, those who live with out-of-control faith recognize that our Heavenly Father has personal blessings for each and every one through Jesus Christ. At Radiant Life Church, we like to say everyone counts, because we know that we can each have a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ. This truth was predicted long before the birth of Jesus and is passed from one generation to the next in the form of personal blessings. In Hebrews 11, 20 and 21, we read, "By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau in regard to their future. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed each of Joseph's sons and worshiped as he leaned on the top of his staff." All these blessings were specific. From Abraham to Isaac, from Isaac to Jacob and Esau, from Jacob to the sons of Joseph. There was more than a broad blanket blessing. In each of these relationships, the Holy Spirit of God guided the elder to speak into the life of the younger through personal blessings. In Matthew chapter 5, Jesus pronounced blessings over people whose lives bear certain attributes that many in the world disregard. But God values those who are often devalued in society. As we see each father blessing his sons and grandsons, we are reminded of the very blessing that Jesus gave in Matthew 5:9. "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Jesus, the Son of God, blesses us with the invitation to be called children of God, to share in His kingdom and His glory forever. It's significant that peacemakers are the ones who bear the name of the Most High, because peacemakers make it their mission to relieve the burden of fear and hostility. Yes, like our Heavenly Father, peacemakers focus on lightening the load for future generations by caring for needs before they arise, while encouraging others to prepare to walk forward in the blessings of God. In Hebrews 11:22, we read, "By faith Joseph, when his end was near, spoke about the exodus of the Israelites from Egypt and gave instructions concerning the burial of his bones." Anyone who's lost a loved one and carried the responsibility of planning a funeral service or making arrangements for their estate and physical remains has felt the burden of attending to details that most hope to avoid. But when your loved one takes the time to make arrangements in advance, a tremendous pressure is relieved as you are freed to be comforted in your grief. Out of control faith recognizes that tomorrow is unpredictable, but there are countless opportunities for extending blessings today by lightening the load that others will feel tomorrow. When Jacob, who is also called Israel, died, his sons feared that the brother they'd sold into slavery would seek retribution for the harm they had caused him. But their brother Joseph had risen from slavery to become second in command of Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. Throughout the twists and turns of Joseph's life, Joseph saw the hand of God lifting him to a place of prominence for the purpose of lightening the load for his family and the generations to come. Joseph addressed his brother's fears in Genesis 50, 20, and 21, where we read, "You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. So then, don't be afraid. I will provide for you and your children." And he reassured them and spoke kindly to them. Out of control faith offers forgiveness where there has been offense, reassurance where there is fear, and hope where there is despair. In Ephesians 1, 3 through 5, we read, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will." God has been about the business of extending blessings through men and women with out-of-control faith since before the creation of the world. And we are called to the work of extending blessings to the generations that follow us by placing our children and grandchildren in God's hands and modeling obedience to the Lord as an example to them. Through the Holy Spirit, we're able to pronounce meaningful and personal blessings on the next generation so that they might reap the benefits of a personal relationship with God through Jesus Christ. And we are intentional about lightening the load for others so that the blessings of God will be multiplied in their lives and through their service to the Lord. If you struggle with extending blessings to others, perhaps it's because you have not received the greatest blessing of all through a personal saving relationship with Jesus Christ. I like to say that choosing to follow Jesus is as easy as A, B, C. The letter A stands for admit that you've sinned and ask God to forgive your sin. The letter B stands for believe that Jesus already paid the price for your sin when he died on the cross. And the letter C stands for choose. And that's exactly what I'd like to invite you to do right now, to choose for yourself to follow Jesus. If you're ready to make that choice, then I'd simply ask that you bow your head, close your eyes, and repeat this simple prayer after me. You can make it your own if you mean it. Dear Jesus, I know that you are good, and I want you to be the Lord of my life. So I admit that I have sinned. And I ask you to forgive my sin. Because I believe that you paid the price for my sin when you died on the cross. And you conquered death when you rose from the grave. And so I choose to follow you today and tomorrow and each day throughout my life's journey. Thank you, Jesus, for coming into my life, for taking away my sin, and for making me a new creation. In Jesus' name, amen. If you just prayed with me, I'd like to encourage you to send an email to prayer@rlclodi.com. At Radiant Life Church, our mission is to share life's journey through growing relationship with Jesus Christ. As we grow closer to Jesus, we discover that the blessings far outweigh the difficulties of this life. Remember, the best is yet to come. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I can only imagine.
I can only imagine when all I'll do is forever worship you. I can only imagine.
On the first Sunday of each month, we come to the Lord's table to receive communion together. If you need a moment to prepare communion elements, you can pause this video and resume playing once you've gathered the bread and the cup. If you're not able to prepare communion elements today, you're welcome to continue to watch this video and invite the Holy Spirit to draw you into communion in your heart. On the night that our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took two very common elements, bread and a cup, and he gave thanks. Heavenly Father, we thank you for providing your Son, our Savior, to pay the price for our sin. We thank you for the body and blood of Jesus, which were sacrificed so that we might have eternal life. We thank you for pouring out your blessings in our lives. And God, we ask that you would empower us to extend your blessings toward one another and those who desperately need you in this world. In Christ Jesus' name, amen. Taking the bread, Jesus broke it and said, "This bread is my body, which is broken for you. Take, eat, and each time you do, remember me." Let's receive the bread. And in the same way, after the meal, Jesus took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Take, drink, and each time you do, remember me." Let's receive the cup. For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he returns. And that's the good news. Jesus is coming soon. May the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.